In this video, I will try to answer the following question. Is it worth upgrading to the new Mac Mini M2 Pro having an old M1 Mac Mini? All this from the perspective of a software developer. And in order to have data with which to answer this question, I'm going to run performance tests compiling native iOS applications, native Android applications. I am also going to compile Flutter apps for Android and iOS. Also, I will build the Godot open source game engine to see how this new Mac handles building C++ projects. And to finish, I will build a small Unity project. I am going to run all these batteries of tests and give you the performance values on both the old Mac Mini with the M1 chip and the new Mac Mini with the M2 Pro chip. I hope the data that you will find in this video will help you understand better the difference between the two devices. Before start, let me detail the specifics of the two machines that are going to be tested. On one hand, we have the old Mac Mini with the M1 processor, 8 cores of CPU, of which 4 are performance cores and 4 are efficiency cores. It contains 8 cores of GPU and 16 cores of Neural Engine. The OS is macOS 13.2 and it has 16 GB of RAM and 512 GB of storage. And on the other hand, we have the new Mac Mini, specifically the base model that incorporates the M2 Pro chip with 10 cores, 6 of which are performance cores and the other 4 are efficiency cores. It has 16 GPU cores, which is the double of the M1 Mac Mini, and the same 16 cores of Neural Engine. The OS version is the same, macOS 13.2, and it also contains 16 GB of RAM and 512 GB of storage. I am going to divide the tests into 3 large groups. First, I will run several synthetic tests. I will do it very briefly and condensed, since these type of tests do not always accurately represent the performance of a machine. In the second part, I will run compiled tests on different platforms. Finally, in the last section, I will execute some additional tests. To execute the test accurately, I have observed the following methodology. Number 1, the Mac has been turned on from its off state. In case the surface showed signs of being hot, I have let it sit until it came back to room temperature. Number 2, each test has been done in isolation, with only the system and its applications running to avoid interferences. In some cases, I have been able to use the time tool to accurately measure times. In others where this has not been possible, I have used an external stopwatch. In the second case, the measurements contains a small margin of error, since I have done the start and stop of the stopwatch manually. I also consider it appropriate to tell you that both the result and the improvement values that I show in each test are rounded. It is not my intention to give an absolute precise result for each test, but to show an approximate value. This means that the value of 50.3 will be rounded to 50 and a value of 80.7 to 81. We start the round of synthetic tests, testing the CPU with Cinebench. We have 1523 for the M1 Mac Mini and 1649 for the Mac Mini M2 Pro. This data indicate an improvement of approximately 8% in single-core operations. Regarding the multi-core score, we have 7,829 for the M1 and 11,801 for the M2 Pro. Here we see a huge improvement of around 50% in multi-core operations. We continue with more CPU tests with Geekbench. In single core, we have 1,765 for the M1 and 1,963 for the M2 Pro. This represents an improvement of 11%. In multi-core tests, the Mac Mini M1 has a score of 7,764, while the Mac Mini M2 Pro has 12,161. Here we see again an interesting improvement of 57%. We continue with Geekbench, this time with its compute test with the Metal API. 21,643 for the M1 and 47,308 for the M2 Pro. The improvement in this case is 118. It's at this point where you can see the largest number of GPU cores in the new Mac Mini with an M2 Pro chip. Now, we move on to Speedometer, which is basically a bunch of tests all running in a web browser. We have 293 for the M1 and 334 for the M2 Pro. Here we can see an improvement of 14%. Next, we test what frame rate each machine can reach by running a three-dimensional simulation with GFX Bench, specifically the Aztec Ruins test in 4K. The M1 Mac Mini achieves 35 frames per second, while the M2 Pro Mac Mini reaches 79 frames per second. We see a remarkable improvement of 126. To finish with the synthetic tests, I'm going to execute a disk reading and writing test with Amorphous Disk Mark. You can see on the screen the results for the Mac Mini M1 and the results for the Mac Mini M2 Pro. We can clearly see that in this sense, this Mac has also improved. Let's start the benchmarks with real projects with Xcode Benchmark, which is nothing more than a huge Xcode project built specifically for benchmarking Apple computers. In this case, we will obtain a value in seconds, with which the lower the value, the better the performance has been. 129 seconds for the M1 and 93 seconds for the M2 Pro. Here we can see a nice improvement of 28%, which can give you clues as to how much you could improve your workflow in case you're an iOS developer. Continuing with Xcode, I wanted to also try running a project within the IDE. I have executed the well-known encrypted messaging application, Signal. The measurement goes from the moment the play button is pressed until the first frame appears in the simulator. The Mac Mini M1 builds the project in 152 seconds, while the M2 Pro in 125 seconds. In this case, we have an improvement of 18%. Now, we move to the world of Android development. In this case, I have run a debug build of Signal, but this time the native Android version. I have used a debug build and not release, since it is the most used command when developing. The M2 completed the task in 241 seconds, and the M2 Pro in 162 seconds. A total improvement of 33%. It's quite interesting if you dedicate yourself to the development of Android applications. Just like I did with iOS, I wanted to try running an app from Android Studio. For this, I have executed Infinity, which is an alternative open source client for Reddit. We have 84 seconds for the M1 Mac Mini and 20 seconds for the M2 Pro. This test shows an impressive improvement of 58%. Now we move to cross-platform development with Flutter. For this, I'm going to make a compilation in release of the Wanderous app. I use release since in this way I force Flutter to optimize the Dart code, and in this way we obtain a slightly denser test. The result of building an Android APK for the M1 is 48 seconds. And 38 seconds for the M2 Pro. We see an improvement of 21%. The results of doing the compilation for iOS is 67 seconds for the M1 and 51 seconds for the M2 Pro. In this case, the improvement is 24%. These numbers are certainly a nice improvement for all Flutter developers. We are now going to test the performance of this new machine by compiling a C++ project. Specifically for this test, I have chosen the Godot open source game engine. This project is medium in size and quite easy to build, so here we go. The Mac Mini M1 compiled the project in 136 seconds, while the Mac Mini M2 Pro needed only 85 seconds. We see a noticeable improvement of 38% when compiling Godot. Definitely a good number if you're interested in this kind of low-level code builds. We are going to see how each of the machines performs executing a project in the Unity game engine, specifically the third-person sample, which is an official 3D sample. The test is to create a clean, self-running build for Mac. The Mac Mini M1 created the build in 82 seconds. The M2 Pro took 59 seconds. We see that in this case the improvement is 28%. And to finish, I bring you the result of running the Blender benchmark. This benchmark consists of three different scenes. We are certainly seeing those extra graphics cores perform much better on the new Mac Mini with the M2 Pro chip than the old one with the M1 chip. As a final conclusion, it remains to be seen if the improvement is substantial enough to justify the purchase of this new Mac. In the case of workflows that include graphical processes, I think the general improvement of this machine with the M2 Pro chip has been evident. In case you are a developer and depend on compilations executed by the CPU, you may be interested in doing the upgrade if you work with large code bases that take several minutes to compile. In any case, here are the results that I have been able to obtain, and only you know your workflow and the type of projects you usually work with. I hope this video has been useful to you. If that is the case, please leave me a good like and consider subscribing for more content of this style. Thank you very much for watching the video until the end. I hope you have a peaceful rest of your day. Goodbye.